Do you get any backlash for having them learn tricks for a snack? I'm curious about the environment and boundaries you keep between bonding with them and letting them be walruses. I love it when people ask hard questions, especially when they do it in a respectful way. So let's dive into it. I'm KP, a marine biologist who has worked at zoological facilities for over a decade. Do we get any backlash? Of course, there's backlash no matter what field that you're in. Just take a quick peek at any of the comment sections in any of my videos and you're bound to find a negative comment or two. But what you'll also find are comments like this, and 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 this. The sheer amount of positive comments always drowns out the negative. You'll also see a lot of comments like these. I've always known walruses existed, but never actually seen one. I've never seen a puffin so close. Wow, this is the first time for me. I've never seen a walrus up close like this. Species like polar bears, walruses, and penguins live in extremely remote areas of the world. So accredited zoos and aquariums are really the only place for people to see these species in person. Here's a mind-blowing fact that I just learned from a conservation organization called Polar Bears International. More people pass through turnstiles in US zoos than all North American sporting events combined. Research shows that zoos and aquariums are trusted messengers on climate change and other conservation issues, reaching millions of people every year who might not otherwise hear such messages. That really is one of my favorite parts of the job. One of the most rewarding, too. It's actually the primary reason why I'm on social media, to reach people, expose them to these incredible animals, and hopefully inspire everyone to take the actions that are necessary to save them. If people are also entertained at the same time that they're learning about them, I don't really see why that's a bad thing. I promise you, the animals don't care either way.
High five. Good.
And if we just dumped food in a pile for them every day, well, that would be incredibly uninteresting for them. Training sessions are just one way that we deliver food while also stimulating them mentally. I also think a lot of the negative comments come from a general misunderstanding of how and why we train our animals. Some people think that we won't feed them if they don't do behaviors. And that's just not the case. Each animal has a base diet that they get every single day, and that is important for them to be healthy. And the animals can choose not to participate at any time.
Come here, Mr. Snacks a lot.
Take Mia, for example. She doesn't really do a lot of behaviors and has very little interest in our training sessions. And that's okay. Every animal has a different personality. Mia gets to be Mia. She's an older rescued sea otter who had a really rough time out in the wild. And now she just gets to enjoy her retirement. Clara, on the other hand, even though she's similar in age to Mia, has a very different personality. She's always incredibly enthusiastic at participating in the training sessions, as you've probably noticed. This video of Clara is a good example of a technique we often use. In this clip, you can see that she's being a little too enthusiastic with her tippy tappies. I'm asking her for a different behavior, and she is just tippy tapping away. So I redirected her by asking her to do another behavior that I was pretty sure she'd be successful in, an open mouth present.
You're a drummer. Good.
That way I was pretty certain she was gonna do it correctly and I could reward her for something that she was successful in.
Silly.
Even if that wasn't originally what I was hoping to accomplish in the session. Another misconception is that we're only training them to do tricks to entertain guests.
Good.
And sure, there are some behaviors that are just for fun and to showcase the natural behaviors of walruses so that people can see those for the very first time. A great example of this is the walrus vocalizations.
Come. Sing. Sputter.
But most of them are actually healthcare behaviors or research behaviors. Take this mouth present. That's so we can inspect their teeth and their gums. Sometimes we even brush their teeth if it's needed. And this behavior where Clara is targeting on my hand and turning her head each way, this is so we can check their ears and eyes. She's even trained to do eye drops. Some animals need eye drops on a daily basis, just like humans. Think about if you went to a doctor and got a plate of cookies or like a glass of wine every time you did an eye exam. You would be probably a little less stressed out and maybe even a little excited about each visit. We train our animals to voluntarily participate in things like blood samples and vaccinations so that they become a positive part of their day with little to no stress involved. The same is true for the research that we do. Every year, accredited zoos and aquariums carry out thousands of research and conservation projects, half of which are field projects in over 80 countries. Accredited facilities spend nearly $350 million every year on conservation and research, making zoos and aquariums the third largest contributor to conservation in the world. I'm speaking from experience as somebody who was part of the first ever study done on the metabolic rates of juvenile walruses. Okay, but let's talk about the second part of this commenter's question concerning the bond that we develop with the animals that we work with.
I missed you.
We do develop a very close bond with the animals under our care. And the reason for that is that it is the only thing that enables us to work so closely with them, make sure that they are nice and healthy, and enable us to do this kind of research. This relationship that we develop with the animals is based on trust. The only reason we can work hands-on with the animals like walruses and sea otters is because they trust us and we trust them. I spent years building up that trust and still do it every single day. When I go into a habitat, the animals all trust that it's going to be something fun, positive, and interesting that is going to happen. Oh. Think about it a bit like putting money into a bank account. So every time I come out and do something fun for the animals, we do an enrichment session, they get a bunch of snacks, I'm putting money in that bank account and essentially building up a savings with the animals of trust. And this is super important because sometimes we have to make a withdrawal. In the example of a blood sample, even though our animals are trained to do them voluntarily, I really doubt that it is their favorite behavior to do. It does likely involve a little prick that they can definitely feel, and I know when I go to give blood, I really do not enjoy it. So that, in some cases, might be seen as withdrawing from your account on those instances, even if it's just a small thing. So we do have really strong relationships with our animals because that's part of having them under human care. It is our responsibility to take the best possible care of the animals, and that can only happen with very close interaction and husbandry and healthcare behaviors.
That's good, baby.
But it's also our responsibility to work towards helping their wild counterparts through research and conservation projects. So I really appreciate people asking the hard questions because the fact that you're concerned about the animals and wanting to make sure that they are taken care of in the best way possible is honestly exactly what I'm concerned about as well. So drop your questions in the comment section down below. Like and subscribe if you enjoyed the video, and I'll catch you next time. And this, what do you want me to do?
Again, like now, actually, point.
Like I'm calling my shot, like I'm Babe Ruth. I know that was too far.
Be more like right here.